Next topic is by Dr. Tan on Raman PAT for upstream monitoring. Dr. Janice Tan has completed her PhD in biotechnology from the National University of Singapore. Presently, she heads the upstream MSAT for Merck APAC. She's an expert in media development and customization for various mammalian cells to produce biologics. She loves the beach, so no better place than Goa, okay, for you. So let's welcome Ms. Dr. Tan. Your thing is here.
So thanks for the kind introduction, and also thank you to the organization for the opportunity to speak at such an amazing event and also at Goa. So perfect place for me after this presentation. Yeah, so I think this is a good slot and also a good follow-up from Dr. Anurag's talk about continuous processing, where he really focused on the downstream part of it, the importance of data monitoring, real-time monitoring, the use of data to do advanced controls. And of course, we have the back-end things that we need to tie all this data together. If not, we have data all over the place. How do you do a process control? So I think for my presentation today is really to bring another upstream kind of context into data management, into PAT, and also next-gen bioprocessing. So real-time monitoring, data, how do you get data? How do you monitor? You need something to measure. So I'm going to talk about how do we integrate Raman spectrometry, which is a PAT technology, to help us really do an inline and real-time monitoring of all the critical process parameters and quality attributes for CHO culture processes. So what I'll try to do is, which I really think that the two speakers have really done a good job, is to how to link PAT and digital bioprocessing and how these two tools will help us go forward to the next gen manufacturing 4.0. And a case study on how we integrate Raman again as a PAT control for real-time monitoring of intensified upstream processes, and to end it off with a summary. So PAT and digital bioprocessing, why do we need all this? So these are the four key market trends as well as the business drivers that is really driving us to go into a next generation bioprocessing 4.0. But how do we go into biomanufacturing? It's not like, oh, click and let's go to 4.0. There's a transition and there's always key enablers to enable us to go to 4.0. So the key enablers will include process intensification, which will really help us to compress production lead time by 80%. We also need process analytics, which has already been very strongly emphasized, to help us really look at our quality. How do we be robust enough to do advanced control so that we are able to reduce the cost in poor quality, so that we can make real-time decision when to release a batch, when to stop a batch, and when to make corrections so that we get a good release of our materials. How do we be flexible in changing our product change over time, because nowadays we have so many different product classes that we really need to increase the capacity and turnover rate of our manufacturing floor. As cost, cost is always a big thing. How do we reduce cost with the use of single use? So all these key enablers are also not something that people generate or come up with these technologies overnight. There's always a phase where we go from today to the end state. And in the middle, there's always some technologies that we need to enable us to go from all these different places to, in the end, continuous processes, single use and closed systems, where we are able to really do an inline real-time sensing for us to have a predictive control process as well as an adaptive plan. So for example, for processes, because I'm upstream, so I'll talk about upstream. So where we go from batch to fat batch, how do we go to intensify each single unit operation before we try to connect them, a few processes together? And finally, how do we do a continuous processing from end to end, from upstream to downstream, which I think Dr. Anurag has really shown a very good overview and a good picture of what he did in his laboratory. So for today, because of the topic, we are going to really focus on the use of analytics, controls, as well as digital plan, and how do we move from what we have today at line, full process control, connected plan, into really a real-time monitoring for advanced controls and really to build a very adaptive manufacturing floor space. So to do that, I think you have heard this term many times, real-time monitoring. So real-time monitoring is really a very key component and a very key enabler for us to really go to a next generation bioprocessing. So real-time monitoring really enables us to have real-time release of products and information. So this is the analytical part of it. So with that real-time monitoring, you get real-time and remote knowledge, which allows us to have a better process understanding. Of course, with all the process loop, a lot of process control, we really need an automation of our processes so that we can do an automated correction as and needed depending on the analytics that we have real-time. And of course, digitalization, digital twin, is very important for us to do simulation of the possible different kind of scenarios that may happen upstream. Could it be lower titer? Sometimes you even have higher titer that we do not know why we have that. And how do we then proceed with, like, say, the chromatography or clarification processes? So all these are really needed. And how is it being driven to success? It's all really using real-time monitoring. So real-time monitoring also needs some key technology to enable this, and this will be the process analytical technology PAT, as well as the data analytics for it. So right now, what we have, the tools that we have really help us to understand what happened. When I'm running a culture with all my pH sensors, DO sensors, offline analyzers, we are able to understand what happened in this culture. So we are able to visualize by looking at the bioreactors. We're able to look at the trends in the cell growth profile or the titer production profile and alert the system, okay, something is going on with this. But this is already a past tense, what happened, right? And we are also able to do, why did it happen? But again, this is also post of our modification, post of our culture. So where we have a better understanding of the processes by looking at post-culture failure analysis, we're looking at the trend, you know, a lot of data that we collected, look at the trend, and then this will help us to make a decision. Maybe this batch I need to release, this batch I need to put on hold, or this batch I need to throw away, right? But really moving on to bioprocessing 4.0, what we hope to answer would be why, what will happen. So if I run a culture, I want to know what will happen. I don't want to know the past tense, but I want to know the future. So this allows us to be able to plan and forecast support, forecast our capacity, forecast what will happen in our downstream processes, right? And this really used simulation and scenario analysis. And in order for that to happen, we need sensors. We need a PAT tool, and these are really soft sensors. So just a short explanation of soft sensors. So there are sensors that do not have a direct data that you can read out of, and usually requires some data processing to make sense of the data. So So another question we want is to how can one make it happen? So if I want something to happen at 10 grams per liter, for example, how do I make it happen, right? So that I can make a proactive decision support. And this all really comes down to have a very tight and very precise process control as well as process automation. So all this will lead us to our next gen bioprocessing 4.0. So PAT and PDA is really a very valuable tool to enable us to go to all this and answer the question of what will happen and how one can make it happen. So one PAT tool that is really powerful would be the use of Raman spectrometry or the Raman technology. So this is too much science and physics or whatever, but Raman effect is really, every time that's a Raman effect, it will give you three different vibration. And because of these three different vibration, they will actually give you a spectrum right at the right, that is like a fingerprint, a unit fingerprint for every single molecule that you have. So the example that you've seen here would be a Raman spectrum of a water molecule. So different molecule, different spectrum, and that's how you are able to identify or separate different molecules in the cell culture system itself. So this is just a kind of illustration of how analytics or how Raman can be used in upstream processes. So first you have a Raman analyzer, of course, to emit laser. After that, this is where the Raman effect happens. And then you have to collect back the sensor. So remember, this is a soft sensor. The Raman spectrum do not make any sense at all. So you need to feed it back into software to generate a data monitoring. So for example, here is like, how can we monitor a real-time nutrient, for example, glucose, right? So with the use of an inline sensor. But we can also use this to further one step, to do a control. And this is, will be a real-time monitoring and real-time control of glucose. So where you feed the data back into your controller system, for example, a bioreactor, and you know, if I have this glucose less than 1 gram, then it will activate my control system, which is my process control, and then do the feed activation and feeding. So glucose would be something very generic and also very important in upstream. But what I really want to show next is how do we use the same technology, Raman, to look at upstream processes that intensify. So process intensification reduce your timeline, but you really need to have good control in order to achieve that reduced timeline. If not, you're not getting any benefits at all. So I'm just going to show a very simple workflow on how we use Raman to do a real-time monitoring of cell culture processes. So of course, you have to run your bioreactor processes. Of course, you need to collect your Raman spectrometry. And because Raman is a source sensor that does not have any sense in terms of the data, you need to collect offline data in order to do a correlation and to build your model. And for any source sensors, you really need to do a data pre-processing, data processing where you develop your model, and then you can start to do and use your model by model validation. So I'll go through them step by step. So the first one would be really to collect data. Of course, you have to run your processes. So for this talk, I would really talk about N-1 perfusion, but we have also done the similar setup and similar modeling for N-dynamic perfusion and also N-steady-state perfusion. So this just shows the setup of the upstream cell culture biosystem. And this is where we have incorporated the Raman technology as a PAT tool for us to collect our Raman spectrum. So we have done different numbers of perfusion cell culture cultures, and then of course we try to accumulate collect data at every 15 minutes. So this is where we do our collection of our spectrum. Of course, again, we need to collect offline data in order to correlate what is this spectrum and what does it really mean. So for this case study that we'll be doing, we are looking at two different process parameters. So we're looking at process parameters and also critical quality attributes. So of course, for upstream, we're always looking at what's the cell density, how's the cell growth looking at, what's the product quality looking at, product title, metabolic profiling, so that we know what's going on in the culture. Is it going on as what we expected? Is it producing too much lactate that will affect our process quality attributes? Do we need to do some changes? And of course, protein quality attributes is very important. So we use this to look at host cell impurities as well as protein targets. So once we have collected our Raman spectrum, we have collected our offline data, we need to do processing. So I'm just going to cut it short for the step three. We do different algorithms to reduce the noise that is generated from the Raman spectrum so that we can increase the signals from the spectrum. After which we have to do data modeling processing in order to make use of the data. So we use qualitative and quantitative techniques such as PCA and PLS and multivariate analysis. After which we do a model validation where we run again similar experiments and see how do the two offline and online data matches. So this would be the data that we have generated. And again, for this talk, I'm just going to focus on N-1 perfusion. But if you're interested in the perfusion data, please write an email to me and I can share that with you. So the solid line in blue is the inline sensor, which is actually our Raman spectrum. And the red dots, that would be the offline sensor. So you can see already from the graph visualization, inline sensor enable you to have a continuous monitoring data of your processes. Whereas for offline sensors, you can only take as much samples as you can per day. If not, your culture will simply run out, right? And the area in pink is actually the calibration range that we have done for our inline sensor. So this data just shows how well correlated and the model that we have correlates inline and offline sensors, which means this model can actually really be used for you to monitor your culture processes, so-called the N-1 perfusion processes. There are some points that is really out of calibration range, so this will be like a deviation where we didn't expect our culture to really reach that high cell density. And this is the point of where you have your as many data as you have. So the more data that you feed into this model, the more accurate this data will have and the more wider range that you have. So this is just a rough one of the first few experiments that we have done. Yeah. Next, we look at antibody impurities, host cell protein, and also host cell DNA. So similarly, we have the inline sensor, which is the Raman spectrometry, and we have our offline data as well. And we are also able to kind of monitor the antibody monomer and also aggregates of high molecular weights. So you can see that there are some differences, but there's quite a line. And we also managed to do an analysis, monitoring real-time time monitoring of charge variants. So again, these are very important, especially for manufacturers who are doing charge variants or biosimilars. And very importantly, antibody is the most common class of biotherapeutics produced, and this is to show the performance of Raman to have real-time monitoring of N-link glycosylation. So you can see that we are able to really reflect inline and offline, correlate inline and offline sensors data for all the N-glycosylation data. So again, this would be the time where you know what's going to happen at this moment of time, and you can really do real-time corrective actions in order to do your to make sure that you reach the end point of what you want to reach. Right. So in summary, I think we managed to integrate Raman as a PAT tool for real-time monitoring of CPPs and CQAs in perfusion cell culture processes, where you know things are happening continuously. So monitoring is very difficult if you are doing offline. Of course, there are some next steps you have to do to further improve the data, right? Data is always something that you need to improve. So you're looking at different strategies to improve accuracy, like doing spiking, data size. The more data you have, the more accurate your model is. We're also trying to look at, can we use Raman as something for us to automate inoculation for culture like perfusion bioprocesses. So I'd just like to thank our R&D and development team for doing all this work, and feel free to reach out if you have any other questions. Thank you. Thank you.